Hachette Audio presents Zero Saints, a Barrio Noir. Written by Gabino Iglesias. Read by Jean-Marc Berne. Para Gabi, el niño mágico.
Chapter 1. Roberto Rowena. Stinky trunk. Fucked. La santa y afilada guadaña. Praying. Pupils invaded by darkness. Beheading. Santa muerte. I didn't hear those pinches cabrones coming. They cracked my skull from behind. Probably expected me to drop like a sack of hammers, but the blow came with too much power and not enough finesse. You can't just whack someone on the head and expect them to go down for good. Some folks have really hard heads. Now I knew mine was, and I had my iPod to blame. I stumbled and covered up in case there was more coming. No hino nada. That was it. Someone grunted in surprise or frustration, loud enough for me to hear it over the music in my ears. El cencerro de Roberto Rowena es mágico. One hand grabbed my neck and kept me down. Three other hands darted in and crawled over me like nervous cockroaches. They pulled my gun from my waistband, fished my cell phone and keys out of my right pocket, and yanked the earbuds out of my ears. With my skull unplugged, I heard a car pull up beside me. It purred like a large cat. I twisted my head a bit. Big. Blue paint. Dirty. Cholo rims reflecting the orange light of a nearby lamppost and six legs, two pairs in shorts and one stuffed in jeans. I wanted to break all of them. The trunk opened and stayed low like a fat man doing push-ups. They shot me toward the back of the car with my head still down. I thought about taking a swing, trying to crack some huevos. That left two more surely packing, plus whoever was in the car. Bad math. The hinges of the trunk screamed like a fried egg under a spatula. The hands pushed me in hard. They slammed it shut. My right knee cracked. White noise shot up to my brain. The trunk lid bounced back up with a groan that echoed my own. Hija de puta. I tried to curl into a fetal position. Not enough space to pull it off quickly. I hugged my knee and looked up, saw two guys for a second. Their faces, black masks in the scant light. One wore a white t-shirt. He leaned forward and tried again. With both hands. Slam! It worked. Then, darkness. The car moved forward but didn't burn rubber. My heart buzzed. I sucked in huge gulps of warm air. There was not enough oxygen for me in that trunk. My chest couldn't expand properly. I was stuck, trapped, squeezed. Panic bit me. La mala muerte andaba cerca. These pinches mamones caught me slipping. They had my peace. I was dead. Muerto y sin poder despedirme de mi vieja. Then I remember, I was in Austin, not Mexico. Folks don't get their heads blown off in the streets in Austin. Bodies aren't hung from bridges or stuffed into suitcases and left on the side of the road. No one gets a box in the mail containing a severed head. Although most politicians deserve it, los narcos don't kidnap them while leaving the office and put two full mags in their brains. Nah, this is a nice, civilized town full of wannabe artists, students, and hipsters. The only thing people fear in this place is getting their tongues burned at their favorite coffee joint. Plus, los cabrones that jumped me were brown. If they wanted me dead, I'd be dead. No hitting or kidnapping bullshit. That's what los blancos do. Con nosotros, it's a bullet to the brain y buenas noches. This was different. I reminded myself to breathe, pay attention, focus. I took another breath. It felt like something. I closed my eyes and started praying to la Santa Muerte. Mi divina guardiana, for protection and guidance. Señora Blanca, Señora Negra, a tus pies me postro para pedirte, para suplicarte, que haga sentir tu fuerza, tu poder y tu omnipotencia contra los que intenten destruirme. I felt better, calmer, more aware of everything. I kept going, the familiar words pouring from my mouth and dragging some of the fear out with them. Señora, te imploro seas mi escudo y mi resguardo contra el mal. Que tu guadaña protectora corte los obstáculos que se interpongan. Que se abran las puertas cerradas y se muestren los caminos. The scythe was with me, la santa y afilada guadaña. It would keep other sharp things away from my neck, shield me from bad intentions and danger. Mi santa muerte had done it many times before and would do it again now. I had nothing to fear. Señora mía, no hay mal que tú no puedas vencer ni imposible que no se doble ante tu voluntad. A ella me entrego y espero tu benevolencia. I could finally take my first real breath. The trunk smelled like an old, rotting sofa. Something hard and pointy was pushing against my lower back. I tried to move, to uncoil a bit, but my shoulders were stuck. The car stopped. Probably a red light. A moment later, the vehicle turned a hard left. I'd parked on the corner of I-35 and 3rd Street. We were going south on Red River. I breathed again and listened. Something obnoxious was punishing the car's speakers with too much bass. Noise filled the trunk. The back of my head was on fire. A warm worm inched its way down my scalp. Sangre. In my crunched sideways position, I couldn't touch and check, so I tried to forget about it. My knee was still screaming. Why was I here? Between the pain, the discomfort, and the circus music, my brain refused to function properly. I thought hard about the last few weeks, months, but no reasons came. I didn't owe any money. I was dealing from the door of the Jackalope on 6th Street, and that was well within Zeta's territory. To my knowledge, I hadn't banged anyone's girl. It didn't take long. The car kept going, turning left and right, too many times for me to keep track or try to guess our destination. A few minutes later, we slowed down, stopped. The driver jerked the parking brake. Engine and awful music died simultaneously. My chest wanted to implode, swallow me, help me disappear. Del polvo venimos y al polvo vamos. But the bitch is not being able to become polvo painlessly when you need it most. I was a wounded animal, waiting. Nothing happened for about half a dozen eternities. Then the car rocked a tad. Doors opened and slammed shut in quick succession. They popped the trunk. It jumped a bit, as if sick of being pressed against me. El sentimiento era mutuo. Then the banshee screamed. It was dark, but a lamppost half a block away threw some of what it had to offer our way, bathing us in yellowish light. Three goons stood there side by side, looking down at me. I looked back. Vestimenta de tipo duro que escucha mucho hip-hop. Lots of ink. Heads thrown back, necks spread like angry cobras. They wanted to look menacing and were pulling it off. Two held guns. The guy on the left aimed his at my face. A black thing. Blocky. Looked like a 9mm in the dark. Ready to spit death. He held it sideways like every pendejo who's more worried about looking tough than hitting his target. The guy in the middle let his piece hang loosely by his side. He was the one rocking the jeans. Both cabrones looked comfortable with the situation. That made me uncomfortable. Mr. Jeans brought his head down. His neck deflated. The shadows covering his face became ink. Tenía la cara cubierta de tatuajes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.